Thank you very much, and thanks so much for coming today. We're just thrilled to be back playing live. We've had a number of firsts already. We had a first live concert in a very small, with a small orchestra and a small venue. Then we had our first full orchestra but outside concert, and now we're coming to you inside with the full orchestra. And speaking of first, we're bringing to you this first symphony of Tchaikovsky. This piece was written when he had just taken a job as with the Moscow Conservatory, which was newly formed. So he had a lot to prove, and he was also trying to establish an individual voice. So it's a relatively unknown piece, especially compared to his later symphonies, but it is a first kind of step forward for Tchaikovsky in terms of asserting his own style. And it was not real well received, especially by his professors, but this was his chance to kind of speak for his own voice. And you'll hear some of the elements that really stayed with him. He called this a sin of his youth, and by which he meant that he still esteemed and loved this piece, although it took a lot out of him. He spent years revising it, never quite pleased, but came to see it as his first important artistic statement. You can hear, of course, the beautiful melodies, especially, for example, the trio in the scherzo, which is a waltz, kind of almost a premonition of the Waltz of the Flowers, which you'll hear later on today. You'll also hear his imaginative orchestration and his use of folk tunes, and that's actually something that goes through all the music that you'll hear today, sort of Russian folk traditions, especially involving winter and Christmas. So I hope you enjoy Tchaikovsky's First Symphony.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
that piece was actually premiered on December 12th, 1944. And it was actually intended as a sort of friendship gesture to the Soviet people, specifically the Russian people. And Alfred Reed went back and found Christmas music that he could use, and actually a lot of it inspired by the Russian Orthodox Church, which actually doesn't use instruments. So it's kind of an ironic setting, and yet very, very effective. And this piece actually that you just heard was originally written for band, one of the very few pieces that started for band and sort of made the transition, in this case, to orchestra. It's unknown in the orchestra world. It's very well known in the band world, and we're very pleased to bring it to you. However, the last piece on today's program needs truly no introduction, and anytime somebody says that, they're about to introduce it. This piece was, I'd like to thank you for that, anybody who, I need all the support I can get sometimes. Unlike that first symphony that you heard, which was really one of the first artistic statements of Tchaikovsky, the Nutcracker came right at the end of his career, and I think one of the things that makes it so strong is that he was restricted in his ability to set the pieces because they had to be danceable and so forth. They had to be not too long, not too short, but he managed to create this incredible piece of music that probably is the most played by any orchestral musician, certainly by any ballet company. I read once that something like 80% of ballet revenues come from the Nutcracker. But so many of the musicians have played it, but you know, it's when we rehearse it, it never gets easier. It's a very, very tricky piece, full of so many beautiful moments. This is one of those pieces that most of us, I know personally, I knew this piece inside out before I could read a note of music, just by listening to it. My mom used to play it for us every weekend, so all year long, I think. Anyway, the piece really needs no introduction, but the beautiful colors that he brings into it, specifically, I'll mention the celesta, which you'll hear in the Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairy. It's one of the earliest uses of that instrument, and it's hard to imagine Christmas without it. And actually, you know, I mentioned in rehearsal, that, you know, whether it's the harp or the bass clarinet or the tambourine, or there's so many colors in the piece that just kind of mean Christmas to me specifically. So thanks again for joining us today, and here is the suite from the Nutcracker.